Well, we've come pretty well to the end of it here.
Well, not according to our measurements.
4 metres short.
Yeah. You've gone right through the middle.
Oh, dear.
Well, we're not going to resolve either of those things now, are we, unless we dig yet another trench across this guy's garden.
Well, we said we were going to do it yesterday.
Right, and across there. And honestly, I don't think we've got time to do that. I mean, if you come back another time and do it, that's fine.
The foundation stone, which Mark uncovered yesterday in front of the gatehouse, turns out to be modern concrete underpinning. The only finds are bits of 18th and 19th century pottery. But this trench has proved that there wasn't a medieval moat here, so I suppose we've got something out of it.
I'll dig my own trench next time.
The quicklime's boiling purely with the heat of the chemical reaction. The gravel for our mortar is probably from the same stream as the medieval masons used. Not all the rocks have dissolved, but we've got more than enough good sticky lime mortar. It's mid-afternoon on day three, and Carenza's just called me round to the inner courtyard.
Can I come on your trench?
Stop that. Remember the cobble floor?
Yes.
Saw this morning. We've taken that off, looking for the garter edge pit. All we found was that post held by your feet.
Yes.
You can see it just with a bit of wood in it. And we didn't seem to have anything. All we'd got was this green stone here that was dipping away and covered by some reddish clay. And we were sitting there, oh no, God, this is it. We haven't found it. And then we thought, well, there's brick in it. We might as well take it off. And we found, we couldn't find anything better. We found this very sharp cut from the edge of this green, which was filled with this red clay. Really striking contrast. And you can see what we've got, this sharp vertical edged slot. This isn't a drain, there's no sign of water washing. It's got stone packing at the bottom. This is a foundation trench for a beam, which would be the foundation of a wooden building. You can see it's coming along here, and then there's a right angle turn in it running towards the stone wall at exactly the point where there's the change from that stone wall to the brick wall in the standing building. This seems to be our garderobe. But it's fantastic, it's what we were hoping to find.
The garderobe was built against the outer wall of the solar. The wall may have extended to form an entrance archway to the inner courtyard, so in about 1350, the whole building probably looked like this. Stuart's had a good weekend, finding the water system and tying it all in with the medieval buildings.
Yeah. Yes, Stuart?
This is the manor here.
Yeah.
There's the hall, yeah. There's a gatehouse.
Yeah.
And there's the church.
Yeah.
Looked at the water management aspects of it and what else is going on. We've got fish ponds out here.
Yeah, yeah.
They're supplying fish, an important dietary element to the manor over here by water management. This thing that everybody was thinking was a moat that I was getting very suspicious about looks to be now ponds.
Yeah, for a garden or something.
That's right, decoration. Yeah. So we're getting a wider picture outside the manor, and we've got a date from the gatehouse. The fish pond, the village, could all have been there at that period, supporting the manor.
Yeah, very good.
So the water for the culvert came from a diverted spring, which then flowed through the courtyard, past the garderobe, and into the terraced gardens below.
Yesterday you came up with this grand theory that this building was created in two phases, but with the Black Death in between. Do you still cling to that?
I do, yes. Look over here. This is the great solar block. It's all built of what I call green stone.
Sort of grey-green.
Grey-green, and big blocks of it.
Yeah.
But if you scan across to here, most of the hall range is of a rather...
It's very pinky,
rough,
isn't it? Yeah.
Pinky-brown ironstone.
Yeah.
Quite different. And then there are windows that are different in the two halves. The great window into the solar is a very handsome job. This is Victor's drawing of
also,
it.
Also, it's four panes.
It has, that's right. And then this central mullion divides it at the top into two, and each has a trefoil head, that's like a clover leaf. And a window just like that would date from the first half of the 14th century.
Yeah.
But if we go inside, we'll see a window in the other part, the part with all this brown stonework, that must be, I guess, getting on for 100 years later. And that's it, the one over there. It's blocked with brick, but it's the same trefoil heads. But above the trefoil heads, there's a little bar going up, and that makes the difference. That sort of window has to be a good deal later. So those windows are very different in date. But equally, there are windows around the building that are identical in date. That one, for example, up there, that long, tall one with a flat top and a high bar running across it, is identical to the one you'll have seen in the solar.
Yes, yes.
And those are in these two separate parts of the building. And all these dressed parts, that's the window frames and the door frames, have a mason's mark on them, the mark of the man who cut them. And it's the same man, a man who puts a Z on his work, right the way through the building.
So are you saying that Mr. Z made all these parts?
He did,
stacked
yes.
them up. Some of them went in straight away, and the rest were left lying in the garden and were used sometime later after the Black Death.
That's right, yes, and he made all the difficult bits of the building, but he'd only built the solar end before the Black Death caught the family. And then they picked up the thing 50 years later, they went to the yard where all the stuff was stacked and safely stored, and they started building again. The one thing they didn't do the same, of course, was to use that green stone. They went to a different quarry and used the brown stone instead. And it was all going to be rendered over, so it didn't make much difference.
So is this the authentic way of doing it then, Ian?
This is pretty close to the authentic way. We've got all local materials, and it seems to match almost exactly the mortar that we've taken out of the building.
Yeah. And is this the same sort of stuff that really goes back to Roman times?
It hasn't really significantly changed since Roman times. The Romans really developed the technology and were masters of lime mortar.
Yeah.
And this is pretty similar stuff.
There's a big stone there. So would the whole building have looked like this then?
It would have had this very, very thin, smooth render over the whole surface.
Yeah.
But these green sandstone coins wouldn't have been covered with render.
The big blocks up the corner.
The big blocks up the corner, yeah. And the dressings around the windows would have been unrendered, but all of this rough rubble work in between would have been rendered. So their initial purpose was really to make it look good.
Finally, the entire wall would have been coated in a lime wash made from the same mix as the mortar, so it would have ended up looking like this.
It's 7:45 on our final day, and we've got to stop pretty soon because apart from everything else, everyone's got to get back to their work and their universities and whatever tomorrow. But we've hit this crisis. It's exciting, but it's a crisis anyway. We've got some strange, shadowy feature just starting there, going through there, where you're digging, Phil, yeah?
I am indeed.
And over here, then it disappears under this building, i.e. it's older than medieval, and we see it reappearing here in this dark shadow along there. And we don't know what it is, but it's big. And at the same time, we've already discovered this beam slot here. Now, we reckon that just about here, there is a doorway. Now, we're guessing that the doorway would have been halfway through this house, if it was a house, which would mean that theoretically we ought to find another parallel beam slot here. But we've got to dig it in order to find out, and we've no time left.
And despite frantic efforts by the whole team, including my own high-class shovelling technique, that was all we found of an earlier building. The beam slot running down the side of the courtyard turned out to be a Victorian drain. But we do know what we came to find out. Just how did Aston Eyre develop from the 14th century onwards? The dates for the gatehouse timbers were between 1341 and 1352, when Alan de Charlton was married to Marjorie Fitz Eyre. The 15th century roof beam and window in the hall fit Berwick's theory that it was finished off over 50 years after the gatehouse. The barn timbers dated from 1612, but the massive stone foundations could have belonged to a medieval building. The story of Aston Eyre is one of continuous alteration through six centuries. After 3 days here, I'm wondering if it ever got finished at all. Perhaps Neil Dalton will rebuild it, but if he doesn't, he'll be continuing a long and fascinating tradition.